Soon as I have the rest of it.
I don't have the news, because I have money.
Well, we approved.
Yeah.
Tom, you read the minutes?
Yes, I read them.
I would move to approve the minutes on Monday, December 26th.
A second.
Bear with me, please, Sarah.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained, was not here. Joe, yeah, for us.
The missiles of Memorial Hall.
Okay, go out. I've got two new contracts written up.
elaborate a little bit on the project. We've got an opportunity to do something which I think would be beneficial long-term for the county, because in removing all these lintels, we're going to take out each and every window, have an estimate of the cost for new windows of about $80,000, $75,000, something in that area, that if you would allow us to at least put that opportunity in the project, we can, I know you have to find the money for it, but the idea would be that you're going to have to put those windows, after you pull them out in this project, you're going to have to put them in anyway. You definitely need new windows because they are, some of them are damaged and not in great shape. But if you can afford, or if you can avoid the cost of putting new windows in, which you do, if you bought new windows associated with this project, you could have them installed essentially for free. Because you're going to have to spend the money for reinstalling the existing windows anyway. So rather than leaving the windows the way they are, reinstalling them, having the old windows put in there, a few years down the road, come back in, you get to pull all those windows out, you have to pay to pull them out again, and then you would have to pay to have the new windows put back in. So you could save, I guess, tens of thousands of dollars by somehow finding the money to put in new windows in this project.
Right. A little more information on the windows. I mean, since it's a historic structure, do we have to go in with certain types of windows?
Yep.
And please fill in that wooden.
No. Okay. No, they would be very similar to what you've got now.
Okay.
The same would require, because they feel that they're historic the way they are, you have to have the same bars and stuff, the same visual.
Muntins and
yeah.
Same jam width, things like that.
I thought those windows were not original.
They are not original.
Yeah, they're a replacement of whatever original. So
they were probably wood in there originally, and if the state considers that these windows have been in there long enough, that they are now considered to be historic. So
we get 1960 style windows.
Right. Yeah. But we can get them thermally broken and triple glazed or double glazed at least. And, you know, should catch your heating and cooling bills considerably. So it'd be a good investment.
And that estimate is $75,000,
around $75,000, $80,000, something like that. That's for the material cost alone. The labor would be over and above that, but the labor would be included in this project anyway. So all you're adding is the cost of the materials to get.
We got to take the old windows out and
yeah.
Put them back in.
Right.
So
right.
It would be a matter of just putting the new ones in instead of the old ones.
It'd probably take a little more labor to put the new ones in, but it would take a lot more labor to take the old windows out and salvage them rather than to stick a sled hanging out of that. So it would probably pretty well be a wash between the two. So basically, you would be getting a free installation of the windows. And in essence, because I mean, you're going to pay for it one way or the other.
Reed, is that something they have to decide today?
No.
Is that like an addendum?
We can do that as an addendum. We can do that. We can do that as an alternate bid, so that when the project is bid, you know exactly what those windows cost, and you can weigh that at the time. It's just something that Joe and I have been discussing, we'd like to pursue that if we can, because it's a good opportunity for the county.
I think that's a good idea myself.
I'm afraid looking into it, I guess I have to
his and stuff. There's some nice space there, but, you know, it's going to be, I'm not really going to put an elevator in there to get people necessarily on the second floor to utilize or to make them into office space or anything like that. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's, it looks to me like something that's going to be essentially storage space, so, you know, I'm not for sure we gain a whole lot by putting the windows in.
You know, getting going is, you know, that's something. Not
yeah, some of those rooms like to be blocked off. I mean, I'm not too sure that we need to.
Kevin, you could obscure the windows because that would be changing the exterior look of the building, and that would not be. Now, you could on the north side, not on the east and west side. The north side, because the north side isn't predominant, and this isn't a need to tell you this, it's up in the Vegas for preservation officer.
I can't wait.
But the north side, I don't think they would consider that a predominant facade. Consider,
yeah, so it's a different brick. It's like a whole
different brick. It's a brick. It's an older brick. But it is fairly visible from the street, from the other street, so the street to the north.
Yeah.
Whatever the street that is. But I think the front and the two sides would be the ones where they would be most concerned about any changes to the, I mean, blocking the windows up or something like that. But we just have to ask and find out, because it does kind of depends on who's handling it and what their attitude toward the project is as to what kind of room you can get on those kind of changes.
Yeah, I'm just looking at all possible options. I think it probably makes sense to go ahead and change some of the windows. I mean, I just have a problem changing windows up. That's in some of the areas where we're probably never going to use, or, you know, for something that's going to be hard to utilize some of that space up there, you know. So, you know, the budget constraints and stuff we're under, why this is a big enough, you know, project the way it is. And, you know, so that's just my thinking.
No, I know.
I mean, we'll just have to tackle the options. I'd like to leave several options, and then we can see which best fits our scenario, and then the decision we make to work out before we decide.
I can have some conversations with the Historical Society to kind of ask those questions.
Yeah, that's what we need to see how flexible and stuff they can be, because it sure ties our hands. I do know if we did this on our own, we wouldn't have to worry about it.
No, you can do anything you want.
Right.
With your own money. It's just when the government has it.
Well, and you're taking a structure that's older and you're trying to keep it up and maintain it, and you know it's well used, it's hard somewhat to justify or to
sure.
Try to figure out.
I know.
And where do you say, you know, where do you, you know, say when? It's essentially like how much. We know it's utilized quite a bit, but. And I agree with you, if you're going to take out the flannels, which, how they got beyond to that point of just repair, right? Maybe long before my time, but it should have gotten to that point, I guess. That's what's disappointing, is that we could have been maybe replacing a few of those over time instead of, was it 90? Or what's the number of flannels that were replaced?
27,
okay. I'm thinking about $90 million.
That's what the state would
get. Yeah. Yeah, so I would say draft up an addendum and we can probably approve.
What I'll probably do is, as I put this project together, I don't think the contract has to change. My contract has to change to include that. But I think when I describe the project with my drawings, I need to include language and a bidding format that will allow us to consider that option.
It doesn't cost you an option letter.
Yeah. It just, I can describe the windows fairly easily without, you know, a whole lot of work for me. And it can be included so that it's just a line item and we can see what it costs to include the windows, the new windows. You don't even have to accept it. You can say, well, that's too much. But it gives us a whole lot of time so that we can consider it in the future. So, there may be some other things that this project really hasn't included. Things like, but there's a steel frame, windows and doors, that gets pulled out, and if it was put back in, because we can't afford the windows, do we want to paint that? I mean, that's something that we need to discuss, and that may be something that the maintenance department wants to do. I don't know. Those kind of little things are things that we just have to iron out. But we can identify little smaller projects that we can itemize, and we have to order them. We have to organize them in the order that you want them, so that we need to pick the alternate bid number one first and alternate bid number two second. You can't jump down to three and then six or whatever.
That would be something to discuss with Morton Hall Board and trustees too. I don't know what type of funds that they have, that maybe we ought to look at those.
Maybe we have some, but I don't think it's going to be a lot.
Thanks.
Same with them. I mean, I'm sure that if they want the windows without doubt, it would help some. Of course, you've got tax credits that would help pay for it as well. And, you know, the big thing is right now is if you're basically getting a free installation of the windows, which is probably, I don't know what it costs, it costs, you know, the almost equal to the cost of the windows. That's usually the way stuff works. So there's quite a little bit of savings now.
So you get tax credits that you can sell? Is that what the county can do?
Yes.
That in itself will cut the cost of the windows by, I think, 40%. So that'd be 20% of 80s, 16,000, something like that. Get back in tax credits.
Mm-hmm. Those are usually a few months behind that, so.
Well, oh, yes. Yeah, yeah. You've got to pay for one member a lot before you get back.
But I don't know what Kansas legislature is doing. I know that Missouri, they're kind of under fire, tax credits of all types of historic things, so.
Yeah, drop option one or option two. I don't know what you're what you suggest. But today we can go ahead and approve.
Yeah.
Okay.
Who are these two?
Three of us will sign. So we have multiple copies.
Yeah, two copies.
I think one finish on the table.
Yeah, just one signature.
Mr. Chairman, I move. You're the chairman on the contract.
To Nash County and River Bluff Architects. For the Sailors and Soldiers Memorial.
Second.
All favors signify saying aye.
Aye.
One of the copies has two tags on it, which the tag in the front shows where I've postponed the retainer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just a little bit. Thank you.
on that, there, now, I don't know, I don't have the money in my budget, I assume it comes out of county general. If you guys approve it, we talked about this, maybe, elevator project was finished.
Mm-hmm.
And the way I understand it, there is a little resistance up on the courtroom to share the break room up there. But this here would make that break room both county, for everybody that's in the courthouse, county, state, and federal.
I haven't seen anything from the courts to say there's a resistance to share this room.
Right.
From the same building.
Right.
Okay.
No formal, nothing formal, it's true.
So, only 41 hours for the year?
It's actually right around till 6 o'clock, 300.
Cards.
Something.
$382.49?
Yes. I'm hoping that they're going to be maybe 4.49, but there's a little problem. We went to.
Yeah. Yes, is there a report?
No.
No.
Not my time with them.
Okay, we got shield on.
I just want to kind of talk to you about solid waste. Rather than having with this, that customers come in my office and are saying they're paying under protest, and my office finding out that it's actually an appeal on solid waste, and customers are saying that Chase is coming to pay under protest, and I prefer him not to do that because paying under protest is for taxes, and we have to have a process for that. We've also had customers coming in or sending in money without the solid waste fee, and then all the customers coming in expecting a refund of that solid waste at the time that they're paying. I think there's a lot of confusion for the customers on what they're doing or what's supposed to be done. And I know for my office, if there's any way that we can get a lot of these appeals processes done before these people pay, it's going to save me a lot of time and extra work, because even when we do abate some of those fees off, it's still going to cause me extra work. And if I have to also do a refund check on all of these things, it's really going to cause a lot of problems in my office. I mean, I'm so busy as it is, and it's like a busy time of the year for me. And it's not a simple process of doing all these change orders and doing these abatements and then doing the refund checks and stuff like that. I mean, it's quite expensive when I have to do all that. It's just a lot of extra work. And also on this deadline, on the 20th, for this appeal, I'm not sure if that's a good thing, because that's the first, the tax due date deadline also. And I don't want people to think that if they're appealing the solid waste, they don't have to pay their taxes on the 20th. Because if they do feel that way and they don't pay their taxes, interest is going to start accruing. And also on the rebate program, if they don't pay it, they're not going to get a rebate. So, they need to be made aware of that. I have a deadline for a distribution on January the 20th, so I need all these things to be pretty much taken care of so I can do this distribution, so I don't have all these refunds coming back out of current tax or out of the, fees and stuff. And then I got to get rebate checks ready. And so it's kind of, I need something to get really taken care of fairly quickly, if at all possible. I mean, these appeals are really going to be hard for me to get all this done in time. And I know I was trying to talk to Chase about that, and he said he's working on trying to get them done. I don't know
what
if you've got a bunch of them done that we could get them.
We have at this point 36 appeals filed. I don't know what's residential, what's non-residential, and no, we haven't had an appeals hearing. And I think as I was
36, so we're at a half percent of what went out. It will be considerably more, but so far, that's what we have. So, with the additional 3 weeks left, 3 weeks and a couple days, or 2 weeks and a couple days, that 10% number seems to be reasonable, and that it would be, well, hopefully it's not 10%, it's more closer to 5%, and that would make it about 250, 300. So many of them are just, all the information is provided, we sign off, and then it's just $61 check goes back to that. I don't know the exact steps that go into the process.
Possibly 300 checks on the...
Well, how many abatement checks do you send out, like typically?
Like the rebates?
Yeah.
Just regular rebates, they were provided to...
Yeah, they were provided.
Over 1,000.
Okay. Well, I know one of the last meetings we discussed, we'll probably need to reissue notification of fees and that date, and you might interject a little bit on that, on the December 20th date, since it wasn't listed initially, or an explanation in the statement.
Well, currently,
it's a different day.
This is something that we do need to clear up. In Pauline's office, she has the official resolution. The official resolution still says the 18th. So I don't know if we didn't approve the changes that we made, because it also still says the $72 and the $61 in the resolution. So we need to figure out and make. I mean, I thought that was. We hadn't done that, but if we need to finalize that, so the official record that's in the clerk's office, if it's the 18th currently, it would probably be a good idea to just keep it the 18th. I know we've got it around the 20th, but the 20th it's going to be problematic for people that are under the rebate program to deal with it. So the 18th, as the appeals deadline, as it was originally drafted, and as it's currently recorded in the clerk's office, we keep that. I don't know if it's approved, the changes that we made, again, so that it does say $61 on the official resolution, because the current one still has the 72, and we keep the December 18th deadline, so that it does give us a little bit of get those in before the actual deadline. Now, as far as if you don't want me to use the term pay under protest, because I assume we don't actually click a box when they pay, it says under protest. Is it an appeal filed for the appraisal value, and I thought it would be the same verbiage if you file a solid waste appeal.
Yeah, because when they're coming in my office, protest, so my girls are going to get attacked, so we have to do all these copies and all this kind of stuff, and so I don't want, and then, these people are thinking we're supposed to be doing something about making copies, whereas, if there's appeal, we're not doing anything in my office except for anything that we've done.
So what would you suggest that I use as a term?
Telling that you're appealing it to pay your taxes.
Paying, but I'm appealing the taxes. Or appealing the salaries.
Pat, a question about date. We need a clarification on that.
Well, due process, of course, requires that people be given notice of what their right is and their right to appeal, and that wasn't done. So, as we discussed, I think a second label needs to go out. Mm-hmm. I think the effect of not giving the notice of when the hearing, when they're appeal deadline was, it's that there really isn't an appeal deadline, or certainly not one until sufficiently after they get their second notice, as it were, to inform them of when that time would be. So I think you could set another date, or you can leave it open-ended, but the additional notice.
which obviously is going to be after this.
Sure.
With regard to the resolution is one of the, as I think, implications of to reduce it, or if they're going to just in minutes. I think we had some discussion about the suggestion was actually to modify the resolution. The resolution was sent out just to have a comment in it. I don't believe that's actually necessary. I think it's just a little bit easier to understand that looking at two different things, looking at a resolution and something that has to modify. Does that answer the question?
Yes. Then we find any consensus on date for the appeals process beyond December 18th or 20th.
When will that move so
ASAP. So drop up a letter, get it out Tuesday, tomorrow's pushing it. How long typically if we email to the postal pre-sort?
Have you talked to them yet?
No, I haven't.
So they have that 10 days out before they can send out my tax statement, so I don't know how they would do it.
What question would you have on talking about on Wednesday?
On these refunds, I mean, are we gonna do them all at once or what? Because I mean, I gotta do a change order and then I gotta pay them off of the actual system and then I gotta do refund checks. I mean, that's quite a process for me, especially if there's gonna be 300 checks.
What do you do on the abatement program?
So I get a change order and then I have to set up a.
So you do like a batch? I do a batch
and I gotta take them off first so it shows in the system. And then I gotta do a batch and get them out of there and then I gotta turn around and do a refund check. So we can do as long as we can and not too many at one time.
Was that 10 days? Was it 10 calendar days or 10 business days?
10 business days.
Yeah, so rather than trying to come up with one today, Chase, I'd suggest talk to them and let's talk about them and say maybe next Monday. Rather than just trying to get some what they really need.
The long and short, we're still going to have to send that. We're still going to have to extend that. That date. We just need to figure out what's the date that we can get that.
Yeah, I don't know that there's a big hurry about it. I think it could pretty easily be February 1st without hurting anything.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Also, I talked to Chase on my budget amount, my salary, after I got a copy from Pauline. It was incorrect. Chase didn't figure it correctly. And he saw that error on there, the 2% increase that was approved for each department. And so he said that we couldn't publish the budget again, so he would make a note of it and have it transferred from County General. The amount that was to be correct of the discrepancy, because my budget this year for salaries is $137,775 times 2% is $2,755.50, and there was only $88 difference between my next year's budget on salaries and this year's budget. And so I just wanted to make sure. He said that the 2% increase was approved by the police department, by you guys, and I just wanted to make sure so that I can make sure the clerk's office knows that that's going to happen.
Well, what happened was you have three staff that are paid through the motor vehicle, so the 2% would have to come from that. So the 2% was actually applied to your budget, and just not for these three people, which would explain why it's only a difference of $88.
The motor vehicle is in.
Right, but that salary increase comes from those budgets. So the 2% was applied to the ones that are not. And then
this is not what the proposed budget for 13. That's not my budget for last year, for this year actually.
So part of their salary.
My budget for this year is that. But see, I had my clerk, my deputy, retired, and I didn't include her in there, which I probably should have in there. So if I was hiring him first when he starts.
On your 2013 budget, but you had motor vehicle tax as salaries listed on your budget. I didn't see that. So how can it not be part of your budget to
further salaries.
Did you increase your budget? You gave everybody an increase for 2013. Yeah, we went from 14.
We did my this year's budget. I changed things around. I didn't. So that should have an effect on all the departments. Got a 2% increase, so I didn't mind if I'm not.
It did. It's just the motor vehicle because the increase to your salary is part of the budget.
So you're saying that this year is including my motor vehicle for this year also?
See, 2012 I can't.
No, it's not.
Well, 2013, that figure is...
It's only 85%.
Because it doesn't include the three motor vehicle salaries. That needs to be resolved, whether the 2% increase, their salaries come out of your budget or they come out of motor vehicle. Because if they come out of motor vehicle, then the 2% increase needs to come out of the motor vehicle. Whereas if their salaries come out of your budget, then the 2% is applied to your budget. And as of right now, the three that are listed as paid through motor vehicle did not get the 2% on the 2013 budget. That I don't know if you go through. I mean, that one, the motor vehicle thing is what screwed it up, and we need to figure out, do we take 2% more per salary from the motor vehicle budget fund, or does the 2% get applied to each person in your department and it goes through your total salary?
Well, 2% should be applied to everybody now, but I paid one to my motor vehicle out of my motor vehicle fund, which I have authority to do that. But that's what that fund is for me to pay people out of that and other things.
Okay, well, then
and that
just
should be, the 2% should be based on my budget this year.
We went through, the 2% doesn't apply to the total number, it applies to each individual line. So to take the sum and then just multiply it by 2%, what we do is we take each individual salary and we increase it by 2%. It seems like a formality, but it does make a bit of a difference.
When you're using my budget for 13, you're not using my whatever.
$88 is 2% of $4,400, and the salaries that you pay from sources other than the vehicle has to be more than $2,400. Okay. When your salary is not, that you said, were $135,000 or something like that.
So. For salaries is $137,775. An increase for the 2013 is only $137,353, which is $88 increase.
And how much of that is paid from the week?
$137,775. None of it was paid out of my motor vehicle for this year. That doesn't include my motor vehicle money. Salary.
I'm sorry, I don't understand. I thought you said the three salaries that they have from the vehicles.
They are, but they're not included in the $137,775 for this year.
So okay, that answers the question.
That's separate.
Yeah.
That motor vehicle fund is separate. I pay my vehicle first. And the control, and then also I plan to hire a part-time person that's going to be paid out of that fund. That is not included in the budget amount for this year.
That explains the confusion then.
Yes,
so
that's my fault.
their
Good, well, thank you for taking the time. This will be
This one is for storage racks for the utility room or for the storage room, which is well enough to buy. It's not very much, but it's not highly This is for the base station at the Effingham location for the radio.
So you guys want to give a cargo compactor number?
$400 we bring it back and say this is true, we'll find out about that. I'll call somebody later. Well, actually, we have here. Pat, do you know with the ambulance recap and chassis, and was that trading in those cabs and chassis or for the unknowns? So I call Brandon and find out.
I have no idea. I don't know if it would be on here.
Usually they have a chassis. I'll call and see if it was considered a trade-in or if,
Do you need approval or?
I just need you guys to tell me it's okay to put that in paper. I'll call Brandon and find out. Somebody here.
Just let me know about this thing.
Yeah, if we get the old cabin chassis back, which we could throw in for a whole year or somewhere.
Scrap or?
Or scrap, I mean.
Well, I'd say that one's gonna be scrap because they couldn't really get it down there.
We have enough.
Well, just tell Wes that we have to haul the other ambulance down there. If we can get it back, we can just haul it back. And I mean, it's worth, at least worth scrap iron price.
An update on the ambulance is they now have another one that's irreparable. And he's taking it on Wednesday to U.S. Coast Works. So they have one Aston Hospital ambulance and our backup.
I thought U.S. Coast Works was giving them.
They're not here yet.
Well, it's available. I talked to Brent the other day and it'll be available. This all happened since I talked to Brent on Thursday.
Yeah, on Friday there, Chuck, whatever Chuck is not down there, that they were going
to
be. It's one of the two. The other one broke down, and wherever it was, and we had to thirdly bring our backup into them. So, yeah.
Hope we got enough time.
Yeah.
So it'll run out.
I know. Well.
Well, I think the way Brent talked, they would give us up to two loaders.
Yeah, there's just going to be two loaders.
Right. So we're
going to be fine.
We're going to be covered. Yet the first one, I don't think is. It's going to be a little after the first of the year before the first one gets back. But if they get started on this other one, we may get it. Because the second one's not supposed to take
place. Right.
The first one was 8 weeks, the other one was like 5 4. This didn't have to do as much
five,
as that. Yeah, you're fine. Yeah. It didn't take near as long. So, yeah.
So in the 2 hours, we'll be with this. We'll walk in with him. He's going to be on the way to.
Well, you got, if word you even got the rescue.
Which is what they're using now.
That's what they're using.
Okay.
Entertained motion to approve the publication of publication 2013 emergency management truck specifications as written.
I believe.
Say. All in favor, same question on that.
Aye.
Do you want to keep a copy for yourself? Is that not on? Or do you not want?
How many copies do you need?
I just need that one
for Pauline.
I said 8:30, so I have time for me to get in here. So, what time do you want? You'll be here at 9:15, so we're at 9:30. Will that work?
Is there any appointments scheduled?
None. The earlier the better because I have a large role in this. So.
I believe.
Okay. That's all I have. I'll call Brent and verify if we get those other ones back or not. Did you guys have anything? The building is done. We're going to be moving all the stuff back into it sometime this week. Everything was good. We did not actually have to end up stealing up the roof like I came and talked to you about. They pulled the nails out, they were raised, and put in screws, which had the rubber gasket. And he said, we'll keep an eye on it, but he recommended not actually doing the rubber sealant right now. So everything is done. We'll get all those back in, and it'll be ready.
Okay. You got more room to move around the other end, so that you got the extension on there.
POs, if you want to do it now or later.
Yeah, let's go ahead and do it right now.
Okay, we'll start with Road and Bridge. I have a purchase order here for 6 1400 R24 recap grader tires. A total of $4,158. And then Cook Flat Scribble got back with me on to do the surveying and permits out at 310 in Cherokee. They do it, it'll be a total of $3,500. If you want me to, I will call and get two more quotes before we go with it if you want to.
I think it's a thing in your place, probably pretty soon.
I have a send a letter. Because we're going to be probably 3 or 4 weeks out waiting for the permits after the meeting. And I'm not sure
exactly. That's
generally like every over 10,000.
I think it's going to be.
Yeah. I don't know if we're going to.
I really think PG will be higher than this.
Yeah.
But
generally they have them.
Yeah. PG will be higher. I'm pretty sure they will be higher. We're probably going to have to do it regardless of whether we get to use the tube or the bridge anyway, aren't we?
No, actually, if we do a bridge, that will be included in the bridge kit price. But I did talk to Bob Chambers with Cook Flat Strobel, and I told him if we approve this, I wanted him to talk to Mike Caldwater before he did anything and make sure what the, you know, the DWR wants to make sure that they get together before they go out and do all the survey and then find out we can't get a permit. And he said he would do that. And
so in other words, this would be a tentative, pending, it'd be kind of a tentative contract pending that they would get that.
Right.
I can live with that, but if it is, you're getting back into.
Right. Yeah, it would be, pending contract. So. And then also with solid waste, our computer out, the transfer station went down and unrepairable, and Wes ordered us a new computer for up there. It's a total of $1,033.81. Actually, I was signed to get it.
It's on the computer.
That's, I called Wes and told him what the deal was, and he went out and looked at it, and I told him to get what we needed, and that's what he actually, that's what he recommended.
I
to hold the bucket on. They're wore out, and that's something we can't fix ourselves. And also the cylinder's leaking. We hold the loader down to Foley's and Spica, and they're going to give me an estimate before they fix it. So I just want you to be aware that we're going to have a potential bill coming up on that. And they haven't given me an estimate yet, but I'm probably going to be in the $3,000 to $5,000 range somewhere in there. As soon as I know what the estimate all is. As soon as Tom signs that other PO, that's what I have.
Probably talk to Chris Cox about that at some point.
getting a solid waste committee team designed by state statute up and going by.
I actually talked to Chris Thomas about that, and he said that he does the solid waste management plan, but he said that Schwab Eaton wouldn't recommend how we go about having our solid waste committee. He said that was totally up to us. He said they did the plan, but as far as the solid waste committee is concerned, that would be up to the county.
Now, that certainly wasn't communicated to us as they were handing out. Here's the form that you need to submit that the committee has. You know, I mean, it's easy for him to say at this point, well, that's not my baby, but when it was time to do something, it's their suggestion to simply fill out these forms and mail them in.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Well, we rely on people. We pay a pretty good engineering fee. We rely on the thing that statutorily they have us in compliance.
Well, I briefly talked to him last week, and I told him kind of what the situation was, and there was some people questioning how we were doing it, and that's when he took a step back. So,
when I first saw the list, it was all county employees, and according to statute, it was a lot different. You know, it's much different than what was written by statute. So,
well, I think it complies with whatever the law government has to say.
Yeah, I think it'd be a good thing going forward. Though, obviously, we have huge interest, and I think a lot of people want to see the community overall improve. But I think we have a lot of individuals that probably step up to the plate. Don't want to put Carter at the horse, but I'd probably nominate Mr. Bauer to possibly be on that committee. But that's something I think we should take a look at in January going forward, and then with the intent of that committee, January through the first half of next year, look at ways that we can get some more efficiencies with our transfer station solid waste system. So just want to throw it out there, we can start discussing.
I'm not opposed to that. Effectively, getting a committee organized and at least have a purpose for it. And so many times these committees are formed, and if you don't put a purpose for why they become inactive, I mean, they become a formality. And if there's no doubt, as we move forward, would we stick with this program or change to some other program or get rid of it for future years? I think that's a good time for the committee to look at, because I think they have to understand the issues that we're dealing with and you know, what's best for the community in terms of funding some of these projects or some of these mandated things that the county has to face. So,
yeah, it's going to be changing constantly with KDHE and the EPA on their mandates on what we have to and do, especially when it changes solid waste. But, and I don't have a copy of the statute in front of me, but that would be something here probably the next 30 to 40 days. Hopefully, we can get something together, and because I think it's a nomination process by some, but I think it would be a good step towards getting more people involved, figuring out some longer term solutions with this as well.
Well, if there really is that much guidance in the statute, it has to be at least 5, not more than 30, and you know, there's a list of 5 different categories of representatives that may be on that. Cities of the first class not to exceed 5, cities of the second class not to exceed 3. But then it also has members of large, and there's no limit on them. So it's really up to you. You have control over it. Might be a good idea to send a letter to each of the cities that are here and ask them if they want to include a representative to be on the committee. And there are also representatives of industry, if you want to ask the chamber. You have some small businesses here. You don't have any big industry, so I hope somebody wants to reach out to Brad or both to see if they want to come off that trail.
Yeah, some large, we have a good balance. I mean, we have some pretty strong business owners here that might just ask for some just brief input on that. Any suggestions on
if you have a committee, it has to have purpose.
Sure.
And some objectives to achieve, and some measurable results at the end. If not, you're just, whatever you want. I'm not interested in holding hands and saying folks are.
No, I agree. You don't want something too large where you can't get anything done. But I think that there would be some pretty good interest, right? There'd be some pretty good purpose to find any effective efficiencies or any even long-term solutions.
A simple one would be, let's just find out how within the commercial street area we can reduce by 15%. If we can do that, we can easily cut the solid waste assessment in half in terms of what we need to fund half year. It's if we can set very finite goals, very achievable short-term goals for the committee to assess how the city businesses, because they're one of the larger contributors of trash, cardboard, and so on and so forth, if they can reduce by 10-15%, we have a lot of leeway in terms of negotiating or adjusting the solid waste assessment in the short term. So that would be one thing that would be the express purpose of the committee, is find out how people can get that number down for us.
Well, you know, reduce the 15% is a no-brainer. Is that right? We had a conversation with Devin about, so we don't.
Right, but if we could take that and apply it, the economy of scale, so that it's a citywide thing, or it's a Shannon Industrial Park thing, or if it's a. One thing you haven't mentioned is agricultural. I know it's not nearly the producer, but it would be a good idea to have an agricultural representative on the solid waste, because, we don't want trash in the future. So. Yes, we want good representation. We want it to be a reflection of the community, but just a short-term, very finite goal would be the express purpose of that.
I've gone by the theory that I'd rather have a program vitally executed today than something well thought out in 6 months.
Right. Well, this would be vitally executed today.
Yeah. So,
and if we didn't get to that number, if we could get to that number, then we could address it to, a higher or lower number or expand, but...
Do you know what happened July 26, 1969? They strapped two guys on a tin can with a computer hooked to an abacus, and they put them on the moon. So if we can't solve this in 2 weeks, it'd be pretty... I think you could get this solved by the first of the year pretty quickly.
Okay.
As far as reducing the
yes.
Solid waste.
And especially if we do have that line of communication that we haven't had. So if we can get that on the one end, then we have a lot of leeway to address the solid waste fee in the near term. Because that December 20th is not getting any farther away. So we do need to make a decision as to how we're going to address it, and then after taking steps after December 20th to make that number viable. So that would be that's my 2 cents on the solid waste committee.
The getting through into June or July of next year with contractual plus additional expenses to run the transfer station, what number will we be at that point?
Well, if we cut the 845 right down the line, and RSV is left out because we haven't decided on what the fate of the RSV is in 2013, if it's quarterly or half, what are we going to do with the $18,000 that we paid at RSV? And then basically everything in the budget is just figured, okay, this is what we need for 6 months, and this is what we need past 6 months. With things like repairs and miscellaneous utilities, you don't know when you're going to need them or you need them. So those are dumped halfway down the line. So what you get as far as the magic number is, and it's assuming January 1st, we have either waste management or Deffenbaugh's. With Deffenbaugh, obviously, having a $30 per ton rate saves us a considerable amount of money, so we need to get to $350, that's not the total. I mean, that is, that's salary commodity.
And the other thing that I don't think people realize is why is our trash going down? We have to have that, we don't know what the factor.
Right.
We don't know, with not much rain, we don't know how much factor materials. Even in the figures that you calculated through the summer.
Yeah.
Probably fairly generous in long terms on some of that, because we all know wet cardboard and wet paper and stuff put in the trash, if a container's not covered, it's going to add to that. So.
Right. But it, like I said, if we can reduce the 10% from the 45 loads that we do a month, it would be 4.5 loads. And if we could divert that 10% out, we're doing 40 loads. And we're doing less, and we're also getting more compact. It's going to save us money quickly if we can just every nth load gets taken out because we divert one ton here, another ton here. It all starts to add up. So that 10% number is very attainable, especially if we have, you know, no businesses looking into cardboard. So that's one of the big volumizers that take up a lot of space. So.
Another thing, as far as fuel out the transfer station, I was hoping to contract our fuel this year, and instead of paying as we use it, we would get hit right at the first year with about $50,000 bill. That'd be another thing to figure out of that. Whether if we're going to contract, we're going to have around $50,000 right after the first year if we just buy the, as we need it, by the tanks, then we can spread that out. But I was hoping to contract it, just try to get a good deal on fuel.
Okay. You're bidding that out this year?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that would bump that 356 out another 25, get the fuels split in half for that 356 number, so that gets bumped up.
But it would cost us more right off the bat, but hopefully we would save money, you know, throughout the year if we get a better deal on fuel.
Yeah, and who knows? I mean, diesel hasn't fluctuated as much per se as gas, but I think it's pretty obvious what we're going to with the current national administration. Fuel's not going to get cheap. We don't get into that discussion, but I think that's a fact. I mean, I know in our farming operation, we pretty well figured it out that this is as low as it's going to be.
The
thing it's going to do is it's going to go up.
Yeah, we've been contracting fuel over at the Ruin Big Bridge for, I think, 4 years now, and we haven't lost yet. We've always made, you know, save money by contracting.
So those contracts were all over for any unused amount?
Yes.
Okay. Well, you move it, okay, so that magic number becomes 25% or 25,000 more. But as far as cash flow, we can reduce the easiest way to do it without completely having to demolish all the systems and start over is just to do the across the line 50%, which means 25. Essentially, you have the figure, you cut up a 50%, and then a quarter of it is now due December 20th, which, as I talked to all the businesses, is very palatable, considering that's pretty much a placeholder for the next 6 months, so that we have that 6 months to do study for them to reduce. The solid waste committee to start working, it allows us that 6 months to get it right. And I think that's the best course of action for us because, the things that we didn't do have been well documented. That has been communicated very well what we didn't do. But by allowing, if we make a short-term concession, it will allow us to get a half year worth of opportunity is really what it is to start converting out, start communicating, start really working on this instead of us doing this as a budgetary thing. It can be a community thing. It does have some. It has kind of a kumbaya tinge, but if we did, involve the community, it will help our bottom line. It will cost us less if we did get people involved. And so that's why I think if we can do half, it won't be luxury, and but we do have the cash flow, and that will generate enough to get us to that next point. And that's essentially what we need in the next 3 weeks, is some kind of solution to get us past that looming deadline, and then it'll buy us time to rework it as we need to. If we need to completely walk away from the solid waste, 6 months, we have it covered. If we need to change it, if we need to double down on it, it gives us 6 more months, is essentially what it is.
Well, hopefully the solid waste committee, form at that point in January at some point, we'll start working on something like that.
Right. So it is my suggestion that instead of us collecting that giant number all up front, we can break it into pieces that, we have the cost control more on our side, but it's more palatable, more digestible for the other side, the taxpayer, because, $30,000, $40,000, 15%, or $50,000 due 7 weeks after they receive the statement.
Well, that's why I suggested the tier rate, that 244 to 488, reducing that down to 244,
mm-hmm.
and then reducing anything above 488, any non-residential over that amount, reducing that by 50%. That would still generate enough funds within that six months time frame to operate.
I'm sure not opposed to trying to help the businesses. I think this hits the businesses harder in the long run, even though there's, my whole question is, do you feel our figures are off 50%? If they are, then we've done something wrong.
What do you mean off 50%?
Well, we're basically going to say that by getting 50% cut in those, we've miscalculated.
No, what the 50% is contingent on is a reduction. And one thing that we did do is we finished the budget after we finished our Deffenbaugh contract. We did have the bid, but we didn't award the bid at that point, so we didn't. We did put $500,000, which is year over year a good estimate. That's what we do in terms of contractual with either Deffenbaugh or Martin's. That's a pretty solid number. But now that we're into, we're factoring in recycling, now that we're factoring in, because of this, some significant reduction, as well as paying $4 less a ton, that gives us a little leeway, because that's over half the budget, is that contractual. If we can address the contractual, the rest of it is that stuff that we have to fund, but the contractual is flexible. Those numbers are solid. We have a little bit more play with the contractual, especially if we can get people to reduce significantly.
Well, that's what's core of it, is the amount of cash is generated. Yeah. That's when the other things are pretty well. You can fix costs for the most part, although as you generate less trash, then some of the other becomes, you can prorate it down in terms of, amount of labor and things like that. So, those things can eventually play into the formula. Like I said, we do anything we can, do that. Are you going to raise another issue then? Is everybody going to pay 50%?
When I did the round, offering, saying, okay, what, if I threw out a number and said, this is what's due in the immediate term, with that balance, we need to address that, because it's not a number we make up. It's a number that's budgeted. It's a number that we need. Unless we get some cooperation and we get people to reduce their solid waste, then that number, if we go down in terms of our cost, then we won't need to generate that. That one's fairly easy. That's straightforward. So what I'm saying is that quarter percent, it's first off a lot more doable, workable than the half in the short term. Once we get past that 6 months, we can if nothing is been done, that obviously that 75% will I mean, the balance of the solid waste assessment will have to be addressed. And it does give businesses 6 more months to budget. But I think most people are more than open to just reducing it. And it also, I mean, like I said, we can address its global issues as a policy. If we want to keep using the solid waste, if we want to go to a tipping fee, if we want to consider any and all alternatives. But this is a solution for the near term that gets us through December 20th. It gives us, it lets us work for the next 6 months.
Going back to the Duffin Bowl, I know there was some discussion, but I never heard anybody make a decision. Are we going to try to sustain the Duffin Bowl the first year, or?
Well, as of right now, I think we qualify under cash basis.
Yeah, I think we want to talk in exactly the same.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I remember that.
I brought that up. So,
yeah. So, that has a lot to do with the calculations and numbers.
Well, it's definitely hitting the non-residentials. I mean, it's definitely hitting them. I really
the figures that I've seen, yes.
Yeah.
I haven't seen all the figures, but I mean, just all you have here is 1 or 2, and that's enough, you know, as far as that goes. The only thing I'd like to bring up about, I've been all concerned about this, is I think we need to consider in the next 10 days. I took it upon myself and I had some free time. I called Heineke tonight, had a few questions about it. And I mean, they offered to be an outside consultant if we had any questions. And I said, well, would you guys need to be available? I spent a couple, 3 days to come up here and help Chase if we need to clear up a few things, and get some of this data. I'm not saying we have to, I just thought to help you a little bit, and, you know, to, from their professional standpoint, I mean, you know, I guess if anybody wants to, you know, look at it, why be one too, but it looks to me like that they would have a maximum that they charge. I mean, they would charge them like 48, I think it says $49 is the maximum they would charge.
And I think after December 20th, we would absolutely love them to come in, and we could have them get a second look. It also would give us kind of a post-mortem, you know, this is what you did, this is the data that still needs to be worked out. We talked to the honey, you know, I think.
Because I knew the KAC,
and then I've called Mr. Stevens and
Simmons.
And they do need to be involved because they were at the inception, but the only concern that I have is that we don't have a whole lot of time. So, I mean, if we... If they came in Wednesday, which was the 5th, they worked on it for 2 days, now they work on Saturday.
Big deal.
I think by reading what he proposed and by the edit that they were coming here and analyze, and they're able to take a lot of the data home with them, and they could actually work out their own, and knowing what time series, you know, I don't know, whatever time series that would be.
If we could move up the, if we file the additional paperwork for a 5-day notice for postal pre-sort, I think that would be a lot more doable. The biggest concern is that 10-day after any point this week gives us a matter of days for people to get their statements and get it in. Granted, it is a reduction, and in some cases a significant reduction in their actual tax, the statement is not even due. I do agree that they should help immensely, especially the solid waste committee, having them come up. So it's just a matter of how much time do we have, how much time do we afford before we have to make a resolution change, or before we have to get the tax statements out and not be, they get the statements the 19th, they're past the appeal date, they're past the, and they have 1 day.
Well, they're not past the appeal date because...
we haven't set the appeal date,
yeah.
But...
That's still going to be extended regardless.
Right, yeah.
That's not going to make...
Right, but we can't move the December 20th date at all.
No, that's set by statute.
Yeah.
So that's what we're up against because people would conceivably lose...
That's why I suggested looking at immediately between. That's why I suggested taking a look at reducing these fees, you know, immediately between, because this is, you know, between now and the 20th, we don't have a whole lot of time. This would at least get us, you know, where we're still getting some money, not the whole amount, obviously we're nowhere near that, but maybe between now and April, May, June time frame, we look at something with that solid waste committee, we start reducing. To find some further efficiencies between that. This is still at least covering contractual plus some additional stuff that Matt had indicated as well.
Mm-hmm. Only contractual is 50% of our cost in solid waste, so anything we can do, starting immediately.
That's not quite 50.
That's 500,000 of 845 is more than 50. But
well, yeah, for a few bit of commodity stuff. I wouldn't talk about what cost to haul all.
I
still reduce your solid waste fees by 176,000 roughly.
Right.
That's what it is.
But.
Well, I sure like to see the numbers, you know, too, before I totally sign off on it. I mean, I want to do all I can, there's no doubt about it, but you may open another can of worms. I mean, by doing that, but, that's what I was thinking about. If we could take it, help you, you know, square up. Because I've been told there's some properties that missed, and that's not.
that's come on up though.
Well, I guess that was one of my concerns, and I think the way maybe I read the contract is, I mean, you could use it for a couple of days, but they'd be available until February. If you just want to use it for 2 or 3 days to help you now, and then later on, after we get through this process, once we decide, they'd be available under the same terms. So, well, Pat should look at it as far as that goes.
If we can get them there tomorrow, that'd be great.
Wednesday, I think you said, as soon as that, because Jim is on a project in Dodge City, and he'd be sending Craig up, is what he said he'd have to do if it was approved.
Okay. So, I mean,
we could take that. I don't know.
We could.
You know. Can I ask a question? I wasn't going to say anything, but I can't withhold.
We expected. Go ahead.
Okay. Does the state still send a check every month to the county from the sales tax?
Quarterly.
Or they send it to quarterly? For the sales tax?
Monthly.
They send it to you monthly? Mm-hmm. And I don't know what it costs to run the transfer station a month, but I think last year the state sent about $700,000, which would be about, if I can do my math right here, about 60,000.
Bill, I think we're averaging closer to 70 is what we're averaging our share.
Okay, and then
if you agree, I mean, that's pretty close. Isn't it?
Okay,
I
about
mean,
70.
Give or take, I mean, here it varies each month. But
right, I understand that. Mm-hmm. But then you also get a check from the city on a monthly basis. And like I said, I don't know how much it costs to actually run the transfer station, what the contractual fees are for hauling it off or whatever. But I guess I don't see, and maybe you'll have to explain it to me, where your shortfall is this month with this, if you have a check from the county, a check from the city and a check from the state, where your shortfall is. And maybe there's more to it than, unless there's an...
joint communications committee.
No, I understand that.
Yeah.
That's still, if you have a $900,000 a year budget for solid waste,
That's 460 for...
Okay. Yeah, no. Well, so that's $1.5 million.
And that's a good point, and that's why I was looking at, that's why I suggested when you start looking at numbers, we do have a balance. We do have a positive balance in the solid waste currently.
And you will get more money.
Yeah, and that's why I said, why not we take a look at reducing these fees right now? Because if we generate about $500,000 plus what's coming in with that balance, I think, and then when we get a solid waste committee together and we actually look and start figuring out what are we going to do going forward in the next two, three years if the solid waste fee should be feasible, but beyond 2013, I think that'd be a huge leap towards, trying to get this thing figured out.
From what I look at, I just noticed this last, it appears this may be the first year in 7 years that we're going to have a little extra money left. When you combine those two, how we've been funded with the sales tax, this may be the first year in 7 years that we will actually have a little surplus. And I'm going to contribute it to a lot because of dry weather. We're not hauling off as much trash. I mean, we don't know how much, whether it's 10%, 20%, or whatever, as far as that goes. And that's what I'm ready to use that money too.
I guess my point is, I think there's every single business person in the community is more than willing to do the recycling part. And
but see, you understand? I mean,
I can't see, and I know I'm on the wrong side of the counter here, but I just can't see the shortfall if you're going to get about $70,000 from the state in January. I don't know if you got one this month. And whatever the city will send you, I don't know, and I don't know those numbers. But I guess maybe it costs a lot more to run that than that amount of money. But that seems like a lot of money and then if you collect all these fees on December 20th, even if you cut them in half, it seems like a lot more money than it takes to operate it. And like I said, I'm
maybe I'm wrong. I mean, you've been operating it on, and I don't know where the change is going to come on December 20th or January of next year that's going to cost that much more per month to haul that off, especially if we're going to start this recycling. And maybe I'm, like I said, I figured just some, a second ago that you should have pretty close to $93,000 a month come in to operate. Now that's, granted, that was for both solid waste and joint communications. And $93,000, I don't know, maybe can't do it for that. But even the additional fees that you'll have, it still seems like a lot more money. And I looked at the budget and I'm still puzzled, I guess.
Well, we did the consolidation because we were faced with the ambulance, and we've talked about how, had we not done that, the mill rate would have been 54, 55 mills instead of the 50 that it is now. It was either you spread it out over property tax and just raise the mill rate to something that, you know, is going to be even more unpopular than what we've done with the solid waste utility. And then the solid waste utilities, and it's how we're able to continue to fund, but it also offers us the flexibility to reduce as solid waste. It allows you to reduce on both ends, so it's not as static as a sales tax. But the sales tax was needed because increasing your mill rate to 54 mills from 48 mills is, I mean, that's no matter how many ways you characterize it and how many times you say it differently, it's still the same amount, and that's still property tax that you're getting assessed to all everything.
The bottom line is, it's really, and then I'm going to shut up because I'm all I want is some kind of solution myself, but it appears to me that it's not really going to cost us any more. It's probably going to cost us less, if particularly if we start this cardboard recycling thing, to operate our solid waste utility, as you call it. The real expense is in the ambulance. And I don't know, to me now, to put a solid waste fee on and then which really isn't costing us any more to operate, or maybe even possibly less, and I don't know, because I know fuel costs, and I don't disagree with that. But on the other hand, what's costing the county and the taxpayers more is the ambulance. It has nothing really to do with trash or solid waste. And I think that's where that is the whole issue, and that's why people like him and myself were upset. We're going to pay, or be close to paying, and I appreciate the chance to reduce that fee to us, but this boils down to an ambulance. And not trash. And I think that's really what people don't like about it, is that you're telling us we have to have these solid waste fees are to cover solid waste, and we actually have enough, or nearly enough, not quite maybe, but we have a need for $600,000 for an ambulance service.
It's more than $600,000. You're looking close to a million. Yeah.
Okay, but my point is, that isn't what you're taxing him and me and Blishmize for the trash, which really isn't the issue. The issue is the ambulance. And that's what I think people are upset about. It's feeling like you smoke and mirrors to get enough money to run this ambulance service. And I don't get me wrong, I want an ambulance service. I want the best one we could possibly have. But let's put it on the table as it was. And I think that's probably why, I know that's one of the reasons I'm upset. I mean, I think my fee is a little high, but that's beside the point. I think that's really what the deal is. It's really not costing us $800,000 more, which is what the fee was going to generate. It's not going to cost us $800,000 more to operate the solid waste next year. And that's what we would have collected.
I think it was closer to 700.
Yeah, it was 780.
780.
But
yeah, that's pretty close to 800,000 to me. But you still get the sales tax revenue coming in. I guess my point is, it's not costing, our increase in handling our solid waste did not go up $780,000. That's why people are upset. Did it?
It did not, but our overall budget did increase.
Then
more than that.
then tell us that we need 600 or whatever, 100,000 more dollars for the ambulance, instead of telling us that it's for solid waste.
Well, because solid waste also presents an opportunity, as we've said, that funding it with the sales tax is just not efficient.
Well, let's step aside from that. May I speak?
Yes, ma'am.
How many notices did you send out? 8,000? Give or take a number or two?
Statements?
As far as solid waste, about
7,000.
All right, 7,000. How many of the businesses are there? 500?
Yes.
All right, 500. Let me do the math for you real fast here. There's 7,000 that's going to get, or there's going to be 6,500 of them that's going to get $61 that's not going to come up here and raise cane about it. Plain and simple. Here he is, he's going to give all the businesses half a break, but we haven't mentioned anything about the residential people or the farmers or anything else, which most of the farms got charged $61. We went through and checked because they're charged to the homestead, not the farm, which right. is also a business, I might add. Because most farmers, even though they won't tell you, they're in it for profit. So that leaves 500. 500 people, 500 businesses, and out of that 500, how many appeals have you had? 36?
It's probably 20, because the 36.
Okay, let's just say 20, real easy. They're going to want to deal with 20 of us than 7,000 of us, okay? So let's go with, they're going to generate half of the monies that they need for their ambulance service from the businesses, or $350,000, give or take a number or two. But we'll just say that for simple math. They're going to give us, and I think if you're going to give us half of it or make it 50%,
well,
that's a proposal. That's okay. 50% off coming in on this first payment, okay?
Over 48.
Yeah. Right. We really don't know. We have a good guesstimate of how much comes into the solid waste. We have what we haul off, minus what gets wet and cardboard and trash, and this is a dry year, and I think that's a very good point. But there's 43% of the trash that is not accounted for. That number is pretty accurate.
I still have questions about where that 43 is.
That's okay. Let's just make it easy. Just call it 25%, whatever it is. I'm going to say that we're still going to have to pay for that. We're still going to have to pay for that. But the bottom line is, they didn't want to have to put a ambulance service on there and raise it 7, 6, 5, 6, 7 mils. Instead, we're going to put it onto the businesses, to where we're just going to have to deal with 500 or less. We can handle those guys. I think that's what the major thing was, because how in the world were they going to assess that amount of money and broaden it out? Now, if your taxes would have went up at home 7 mils, or on most people's residential properties, there would have been an uprising. Now there's just a little bubble. I got to ask these couple questions. For one, the city is already implementing a recycling program that's going to cost approximately $138,000. They're already going to do that. They've already got that in the plan.
Right.
So even without the commercial properties voluntarily trying to cut 15%, which I think I've already started my businesses doing that, and I'm sure that as few of businesses as there are now compared to what there was, Bush Mize has already been recycling for years.
Right.
A lot of these businesses are already recycling. But as I think total consumption and what you're hauling off is going to take care of that savings pretty much by itself. I think the city already has a plan in place. But what it really comes back to, you know, as a lot of people ask me, we got a trash problem? We don't think we have a trash problem. We've already paid all of our, we pay sales tax to take care of that. Again, I go back to the illusion that we've had. Really, it comes back to the ambulance problem. We're mandated to have this ambulance. Did we ever look at the benefit district or a benefit district that we're increasing this ambulance service to? Was that ever looked at?
Putting it in place.
Well, isolating it, or are you talking about like still keeping two separate services or splitting? You're talking about Western half.
I don't know. What I see is possibly we're making ALS service advanced life saving and all of this advanced countywide with equal coverage, with the increase of that being, I guess, out in the western half of the county, which, don't get me wrong, I want everybody covered as best we can. But has it been, again, I mentioned just a little bit ago about the businesses that are, every farmstead is being assessed $61 or whatever the house is. Is there anything being assessed to any of the property where the money is generated? I mean, is there any way, I think the solid waste committee is going to be, it needs to be done. So really, we don't have a solid waste problem. Sure, we can reduce and save some money there. But really, we have an ambulance situation. We have a budgetary ambulance situation. It may say solid waste assessment on our taxes, but it's an ambulance. It's an ambulance charge. So with that said, and we looked at our funding options coming in as far as looking at whatever it may be in a combination thereof of tipping fees of this nature. I mean, have we really investigated that? And with this, sometimes you develop committees just so we have a nice warm fuzzy feeling, and really I'm not interested in nice warm fuzzy feelings. I want solutions. I don't know. We already got the problem. But going back to cutting it half and going in, I wouldn't be in a hurry to get much done, except for by the time the 1st of April comes out, when my taxes come out, we'll know what we're doing. When the county appraiser comes up to me and sends me a notice and says, hey, this is where your taxes are going up, that's where we should have this assessment on there, so we don't have to duplicate mail it out. I think May, June, July is way too late. Way too late. Personally, I think this assessment thing just needs to be wiped off, and we need to seriously look at how we're spending, or we're telling the people how we're spending their money as far as the sales tax money coming in. There is absolutely no way that you're going to get anybody to go out here and convince the public that they're going to do away with that tax and make their taxes go up. It's just not going to happen. Most people don't understand that that's a general use tax. What they voted on means nothing. Am I right?
The way it was voted.
I'll give you a great example. In 1981, in the city of Atchison, they put on a 1 cent sales tax to do what? Does anybody know?
Buy a fire truck.
It's still on. How many fire trucks do you think they've bought since then? Now, that might have been the aerial unit that they've had for 25, 30 years. But I'm sure that bond has been paid. That's been paid off. So, again, I go along with Bill to an extent. We need to go ahead. I think cutting it in half will be a good gesture, good faith, but don't put it back on.
It's not just that, though. If, you know, financially we can make it work. I mean, why do we need to generate any more than we need to run this operation?
Hey, it doesn't have anything to do with it, because we have enough money to operate the operation. We've always had enough money to operate the operation.
Within reason.
And again, working well with the city, I'm sure that you can negotiate some of that. But they are putting forth, taking, apparently accounting-wise, they're not taking any money out of the money that they're already handshaking and agreed to give to you to implement their own recycling program.
They also have another avenue for revenue. It's not getting, I don't get out of the city, but they also charge additional fee to be picked up outside of I mean, so they got a little bit of mix of revenue.
But always remember something, Jeff. We're all county residents.
And I agree. I'm just saying
everybody's getting a $61 charge plus our $11.49 because we choose to be in the city. So that's our tipping fee. Would you agree with that? That's our tipping fee.
Yeah.
Living in the city.
Yeah.
Yeah. What I can see is we're going to eventually put one contractor out of business or greatly, unless he changes and wants to invest a lot of money, you know, and he's not here to defend himself, but it'd be Martin's Trash Service. I mean, as I reduce, I'm not going to need that big of a dumpster if I need one at all.
Well, that's probably, I think, all honest enough, is, you know, but I think you're right. I mean, my intentions, and I've had meetings with my master's there, is my intentions was to use just a small portion, just because we had a mill levy on the ambulance before.
You had one that you were already supplementing with $400,000 originally, weren't you? To the hospital? What was your
supplement? No, it was the hospital, $320.
$320, $312.
Well, but see, there was some money in the EP budget to cover the volunteer service.
Yeah, so $70,000. We estimated about $400,000.
So, we're still there at $400,000. There are
here.
No problem.
discussion?
No, I think it's fine. I mean, it's
better. And there's a motion to pass resolution number 2012-1356 for financial statements, financial reports, for KSA statute 75-1128, cash basis.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Have a second.
Okay.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The only thing I will say about this was, at least if they would vacate it, it is, we are losing the bridge. How do we deal?
Yeah.
So, and that's one.
You're not going to do
it. But I mean, you know, I use that. Use that.
I'm sure there are.
It's
actually, yeah, it's close to Palms. It's actually a rock road. It's a rock. Not a dirt road.
Did you know that?
No, I didn't. They didn't tell me either. Okay.
Well, they would have to, if they published it, then they'd have a right to come and search it or not if they. But here again, how you want to make these? You think they'll see the notice? That's the question.
Oh, I can probably guarantee you everybody will see the notice.
So, especially if Lancaster Township got one. So that's the road line you rolled.
No.
If this were all of his.
Yeah. Gus Walmer used to live about right in the middle of that.
But this is 3:18.
Well, Chuck can say whatever he wants to, but.
Well, I don't know. I'm just saying.
I'll just make sure I got my bearings here.
So, I'll second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.